Freedom is not free. Freedom is not free. In the year 2012, the last year we have records, for complete records for already, the Free National School Lunch Program. Are you familiar with the Free National School Lunch Program? You know, children who are come from poor homes or homes where the means are not as well, they either get a free lunch and breakfast now at school, or they may get a reduced price one, this free lunch. But you might want to know that it cost $11.6 billion in 2012. The free lunch program cost $11.6 billion. You know that there's a free service in America for the poor folks called Medicaid for people who can't afford health insurance. This free health insurance, would you like to know what this free health insurance costs? Well, in 2012, it cost over $415 billion, that's with a B, billion dollars. That's what this free program cost. Well, if you're not presently in our chapel with us, and everyone I'm speaking to in the camera isn't right now, we have services here at Smyrna, and we offer a free broadcast. But you know what? These free broadcasts cost X number of dollars, don't they? That's right. There's electricity involved also that we have to pay for, even for those of us who are here. We have maintenance of the chapel. This free service costs money. Do you get what I'm coming to? If you came to our free camp meeting this last year, by now you should know it wasn't free. It cost a lot. We had to rent porta-johns. We had to pay travel expenses for speakers. We had all kinds of miscellaneous expenses of many kinds. I suppose the greatest law or rule of economics, very simply stated, is that there is no such thing as a free lunch. In fact, I think we could have given the sermon title today this, that free is the quintessential oxymoron. Because the reality is, friends, there is nothing free to everyone. I know I've oftentimes told people, I said, we have a free Bible course, it's free to you. And it is free to the people, but you know what? It cost me, or it cost someone something. Everything that's, quote, free, cost someone, somewhere, something. Even love isn't free. Because you see, it takes time and effort to build a relationship, a true loving relationship, and it takes time and effort to maintain it. And a person who never expends time or effort to display love to their spouse reveals, friends, that the love is gone, or if it was ever there to start with. No, nothing is free, and that includes freedom. Near Pittsburgh Landing in Tennessee, there was built a little log cabin, or a little log chapel. It was named Shiloh. Does that ring a bell with anyone? Can you raise your hand if that rings a bell with anyone? I see one student in history, two or three. One of the greatest, in fact, the worst beginning battle of the war between the states, the United States, was fought at Pittsburgh Landing by the Tennessee River. And as the troops were camped around this little chapel called Shiloh, the battle became known as the Battle of Shiloh. Shiloh means place of peace. But at this place of peace, there were more casualties, more American casualties than in every previous war Americans had fought in combined, at Shiloh. General Grant, speaking of that battle, you could walk across the whole battlefield stepping on just dead bodies without ever touching the ground. There were so many dead people. Of course, that was just Shiloh. There's many casualties at Shiloh as there were at Waterloo, but we had 20 more Shilohs to fight before that war was ended. Trying to fight for freedom for people. We can fast forward our history a little bit. About 50 years later, half a century, between 15 and 18 million people died as a result of the Battle of World War I, in an effort that people could be free. But that even paled compared and they thought it was the war to end all wars. It was the World War. But that even paled compared to World War II, when there was upwards to 100 million casualties. People who died on the battlefield, people who died of disease, civilian prisoners. Up to 25 million Russian people died in that war, and they never even got their freedom. But there is a freedom that we as Christian people are to seek. But it's also a freedom that is not free. There's a true freedom the Bible speaks about. In John chapter 8, Jesus speaks to us. And we'll begin in verse 31. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, "If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, "We be Abraham's seed, and we're never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?" Now, there's two words that we're contrasting here. Bondage and free. Bondage and free. They're totally different words, of course, and one's just not simply the opposite of the other here. To be in bondage means to be a slave. To be free means that you're not a slave, though. And they said, "How is it that you would say this? For we have never been in bondage to any man." Verse 34, Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin." And that word servant means slave. It means slave. "And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth ever. If the son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be what? Free. You shall be free. You shall be out of bondage. You shall not be in mastery to any man. You shall not be in mastery to sin. And you'll be free indeed." But friends, this freedom that we will see so plainly and clearly in the Bible is talked to us about as being free, cost. It cost a lot. In John chapter 3, verse 16, it says that it cost the life of the Son of God. It cost the life of Jesus Christ. I read the story about a fairly obscure Flemish painter. And he was pretty poor, worked in a clammy basement in terrible conditions. But one day he was modeling with clay, and he believed that he had finished his masterpiece. But it was cold, no heat in his place. And he was afraid that at night his clay would freeze and crack and ruin. And so he took his best coat and covered his sculpture with it. And he was found the next morning he had died of exposure. His cherished statue, though, was found unharmed. The sacrifice of warmth had saved it. And in some thoughtful way, beyond our ability to conceive or to comprehend, the cross is God's voluntary cloak of warmth draped over his creation in mercy. The cost of our justification. The cost of our justification, first of all, it has been purchased, seemingly free for us. Romans chapter 3, if we could turn there, and verse 24, the Apostle Paul says that we are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. How are we justified? Freely. Freely. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 32, Paul speaks of the extent of God's gift. Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. "He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?" He freely gave us of his son. And he says there's nothing else that he will not but freely give to us if he's given his son. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 12. "Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God." God offers us grace, peace, mercy, kindness through Christ. And all this cost. In Revelation chapter 21, he emphasizes here twice in the end of the apocalypse the freeness of what he wants us to have. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 6. And he said unto me, "It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely." He could have just said, "I will give you this," but he's emphasizing, "I give this to you freely. In my hand no price I bring, simply to the cross I cling." In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17, "And the Spirit and the Bride say, Come, and let him that heareth say, Come, and let him that is athirst come, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life," how?
Freely.
That's pretty good, isn't it? Freely. You know, Kroger's doesn't have that program. Walmart doesn't have that program. I go in there, they expect me to put the cash in the machine or slide my card in and pay for everything, don't they? I bought some broccoli yesterday. It was nice looking broccoli. I had to pay for it. Bought some peppers. They were nice looking peppers, but I had to pay for them. In fact, there wasn't an item one. I was in Sam's Club, and those of you familiar with Sam's Club know the procedure that when you go out, you have to have your receipt. And the person looks at the receipt. Well, I'd made my purchase, and then I remembered, you know, I didn't get the celery. I was going to get some celery. And so I went back, got the celery, but that was on a second ticket. So I took the second ticket and I just stuffed it in my pocket. Held the first ticket out. I know Linda, I've met her there, I've talked to her several times. The lady sometimes meets you at the door as you go out. "Having a good day, Linda?" "Oh yes, good day." "So here's my receipt." And she looks at it, and she looks and starts to calculate again. And she's looking at it again. I said, "Is there something missing?" "Yes, it seems like something's wrong." I said, "Oh, that's right, because you need this receipt too." And she smiled at me. She says, "You were testing me, weren't you?" And I said, "Yes, I was." But I wasn't going to get out there without that celery being accounted for, because it had to be paid for. However, if you'll turn with me to Isaiah 55 and verse 1. "Ho to everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters." That harks back to Revelation 21 and 22, doesn't it? And also to what Jesus said in John chapter 8. And he says, "And he that hath no money, come ye and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price." God says he's going to offer his blessings to us, friends. Without our money, without our price, because, friends, our money and our price can't buy it. It's not worthy to buy what he offers us. But he offers it to us freely. We've been told in a review and held of March 15, 1887, this: "Men are not to rejoice in their wisdom, their strength, or their riches, but in the fact that they have a knowledge of Christ. This knowledge is the most excellent, the most precious that we can possess. It is the pledge of everlasting life. For this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Money cannot buy it, intellect cannot grasp it, power cannot command it, but to all who will accept it, God's gracious grace is freely given. But men may feel their need, and renouncing all self-dependence, accept salvation as a gift. Those who enter heaven will not scale its walls by their own righteousness, nor will its gates be opened to them for costly offerings of gold or silver, but they will gain an entrance to the many mansions of the Father's house through the merits of the cross of Christ." Free to each one of us, but costly to God. It cost God the life of his Son, John 3:16. In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 10, it says, "He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that," and what is the record? "That God gave of his Son." He didn't lend him to us. He gave him to us. That's pretty good. In Isaiah chapter 53, Isaiah chapter 53, we find this beautiful, quintessential report of our Lord's death and His sufferings. In verse 3, it says, He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Verse 4, Surely He bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem Him smitten, stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of His peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. The Bible goes on to say in verse 10, Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. He has made his soul an offering for sin, and he is numbered with the transgressors. In Patriarchs and Prophets, on page 154, we are told it was to impress Abraham's mind with the reality of the gospel, as well as to test his faith, that God commanded him to slay his son. The agony which he endured during the dark days of that fearful trial were permitted that he might understand from his own experience something of the greatness of the sacrifice made by the infinite God for man's redemption. No other test could have caused Abraham such torture of soul as did the offering of his son. God gave his son to a death of agony and shame. The angels who witnessed the humiliation and soul anguish of the Son of God were not permitted to interpose, as in the case of Isaac. There was no voice to cry, "It is enough." To save the fallen race, the King of Glory yielded up his life. What stronger proof can be given of the infinite compassion and love of God that he spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all? How shall he not with him also freely give us of all things? And we read that in Romans 8:32 earlier. And that's Patriarchs and Prophets, page 154. So it cost God something, didn't it? It cost him terribly. I think it's a beautiful thing when married couples can have children. Most who do anymore aren't. Sadly. But there's something you learn experientially that it's just about impossible to learn any other way. That is the value of a child, the value of a son. And I know that any of us who are sick today, we don't like to be sick. But if our child is sick, we would 10 times rather be sick, have that sickness or even death, than to have our child seriously ill or hurting.
Amen.
I know I prayed when my son was dying of cancer, I prayed and prayed God to give me the illness and let him live. And it wasn't a hard prayer. But God gave something, friends, and when he gave his son, the agony the death of the cross that Jesus experienced was torture to our God. But yet, I'd like to propose that, in a sense, though salvation is freely given, it will cost us also something. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm going to read to you three short words. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 31. The last three words of this verse. I die daily. There's going to be a cost to receive this free salvation, friends, that we have to bear. And that is the cost of self. The surrender of self to God. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 37, Jesus made a profound statement. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. In other words, he's saying, look, there can't be anything between you and me. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with what? All thy heart, soul, mind, and strength, friends. All that we have, whether it's our family or ourself, has to be laid upon the altar and given to God if we want to accept this free salvation that He gives us. You know, in our church, I'm going to speak for our church, not anything beyond our local congregation. We don't baptize smokers. We don't baptize people who drink alcohol. We don't baptize people that want to use jewelry and things like that. Why? Why? Why don't we just baptize smoking people? Why don't we baptize people who are alcoholics? Current alcoholics. Because we believe that God expects people to surrender these things to Him if they really love Him. And that if they don't surrender these things, they haven't really given their life to Jesus. They haven't made that commitment. The commitment. You know, the hen lays the egg, but the porker puts the bacon on the table, and he's the one who made the commitment. And are we making a commitment, friends? God expects us to make a commitment. There is something we have to give to Him if we want to accept this free salvation. And this freedom that He offers demands change. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it says that any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things become new. And they have to be. They have to change if we are in Him. And if they don't change, it means, friends, that we're not in Him. It's that simple. In John chapter 17, I said our justification costs, and it does. But I want to tell you something else that costs, and that's our sanctification. In John chapter 17, and verse 19, Jesus says, "And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth." Remember Jesus said that you shall know the truth, and truth will make you free? Truth will set us free, the truth will sanctify us. And Jesus says, "I sanctify myself, so that they too can be sanctified." It costs Jesus something to sanctify us. And it will cost us something too. In Acts chapter 26, in verse 13, the Apostle Paul, recounting his experience with Christ, says, "And at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue." Now notice, someone speaking to him, and who is this that's speaking?
Jesus.
Now, it may not be in red in your Bible. You know, some red letter edition Bibles don't have this in red. But now the words we're reading are the words of Jesus. So keep that in mind. "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And now Paul responds. "I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said to me, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet." Now this is still Jesus speaking. "For I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee." Who's still speaking?
Jesus.
And who's speaking now in verse 18 as we begin?
Jesus.
"To open their eyes and to turn them from the darkness to light, from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me." We can be sanctified by the faith in Christ. And that's what Jesus said. And I believe that. And so He has made available to us sanctification freely. In James chapter 1, though, we are told that this does not mean, friends, that we will be free from troubles and free from trials. In James chapter 1, verse 2, James says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations." Not just one, Granny Ann. Diverse, many, various, different. It says, "Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh what?"
Patience.
"Worketh patience." And patience, friends, is an element of character development. I would like to propose to you that while salvation is full and free, and justification is free to us, and sanctification is free to us, We have to surrender ourselves to God and allow Him to work in that. And yet, one thing that God does not give us, friends, He does not give us character. Character is something that must be formed. Character is something that must be developed. Character involves personality. And God doesn't destroy personality, friends. God doesn't change personality in that sense, that He just takes it from pile A and puts it in pile B over here. Character and personality are something that are formed. And I'd like to read to you now something from the book Acts of the Apostles, page 532. The work of transformation from unholiness to holiness is a continuous one. Day by day, God labors for man's sanctification, and man is to what? Wow. To cooperate with Him, putting forth persevering efforts in the cultivation of what? Right habits. Because, let me just pause there. We've talked about actions and habits and character before, haven't we? In their relationship. They're continuing. He is to add grace to grace, and as He thus works on the plan of addition, God works for him on the plan of multiplication. That's faster addition. Do a lot more. Our Savior is always ready to hear and answer the prayer of the contrite heart, and grace and peace are multiplied to His faithful ones. Gladly He grants them the blessings they need in their struggle against the evils that beset them. And then, continuing, this is from Acts of the Apostles also. This is page 559. And it says this. This is the will of God, the Apostle Paul wrote, even your sanctification, 1 Thessalonians 4:3. The sanctification of the church is God's object in all His dealings with His people. He has chosen them from eternity that they might be holy. He gave His Son to die for them, that they might be sanctified through obedience to the truth, divested of all the littleness of self. Continuing, for them He requires a personal work, a personal surrender. God can be honored by those who profess to believe in Him only as they are conformed to His image and controlled by His Spirit. Then, as witnesses for the Savior, they make known what divine grace has done for them. That's good, isn't it? But that's not, I think, almost as good as this. And this is taken now from Christ's Object Lessons, page 330. It says, God will accept only those who are determined to aim how? High. Aim high. He places every human agent under obligation to do his best. Moral perfection is required of the preachers, the deacons, the elders. Moral perfection is required of all. Never should we lower the standard of righteousness in order to accommodate inherited or cultivated tendencies to do wrong. And then on page 330, she says this, but Christ has given us no assurance that to obtain perfection of character is an easy matter. Let me just stop there. If everything was given to me as a gift in this process, wouldn't it be sort of easy? Mm-hmm. But there's a character development. Now, I know there's going to be some people who, if they hear this sermon today, they're going to say that what I'm telling you is heretical, friends. But I'm just telling you what the statement says. And if I'm heretical, this statement is heretical, and the author who wrote it is heretical. But Christ has given us no assurance that it is that to obtain perfection of character is an easy matter. A noble, all-rounded character is not inherited. It does not come to us by accident. A noble character is earned. Wait a minute. Whoa. Earned? That sounds a little strong, doesn't it? It says, a noble character is earned by individual effort through the merits and grace of Christ. It comes to the merits and grace of Christ, friends, but it's something that we have to receive as we form it, working with Him. It says, God gives the talents, the powers of the mind. We form the character. It is formed by easy, laid-back daydreaming. Is that what the statement says?
Yeah.
How is character formed? It is formed by hard, stern battles with self. That is the greatest enemy you and I face. It's the battle of self. Conflict after conflict must be waged against hereditary tendencies. We shall have to criticize ourselves closely and allow not one unfavorable trait to remain uncorrected, because as we learned in Sabbath school, one sin will keep us out of heaven. Friends, God gives us salvation, but we must develop a character as we work with Him in the divine plan of cooperation. And God wants us to have this freedom, to be free from sin, to be free from that which would entangle us with eternal loss. And He wants us to hold on to that liberty too. In Galatians chapter 5, in verse 1, stand fast therefore in the, what's the next word? In the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us what? Free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Now, we understand that in the book of Galatians, one of the great issues was circumcision. One of the great issues dealt with the concept of whether these new converts, these Gentile converts, were going to keep the ceremonial law or not. And Paul is telling them to not be entangled in this bondage. You have a freedom from Christ. But you see, friends, this freedom works in more than one way, because the bondage works in more than one way. These people at this time, their issue was whether they were going to deal with the ceremonial law or not. And I would say for most of us, that's not the issue today. For some, it still is, sadly. And they should read Galatians 5:1. But there's another type of bondage today, and that is a bondage that says that you are free to not be bound by the moral law. Did you get that?
Yes.
There's a type of bondage that says you are free to not be bound by the moral law. But you see, friends, that only really brings bondage. When we try to remove God's law, or downplay God's law, or say God's law isn't so important anymore, or we say God's law is not a transcript of His character anymore, we are setting ourselves up not to have liberty, but to have bondage. Because it's when we walk in His commandments, friends, that we have freedom. When you break the laws of the United States of America, you end up in jail. You lose your freedom when you break law, friends. It's when you walk in law that you have freedom. I think about the prodigal son, as spoken of in Luke 15. You know, he thought he was getting away from his father's restraints, laws, rules, and regulations. And when he got to that far away country, he made sure to get far away. But you know what, Thomas? Word still got back. Because remember what his brother said? This thy son, he's wasted his riotous living with harlots and wine bibbers. He knew. Word got back. And sometimes we think we hide things, but word gets back. See? But he went to a faraway country, thinking that he could put all this out of his mind and his father's watchfulness over him out of the way. And he found out he got in pretty bad bondage. He got in a terrible state because of that. And there's a church in Revelation chapter 3 that thinks it's in great liberty, and yet it's in slavery to sin. It's called Laodicea. It's called Laodicea. But the Apostle Paul tells us that we are to hold fast the liberty. The liberty we have given us, we can hold fast to because we are walking in the law of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13, Paul says, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong. We're to stand fast in the faith. That's where the liberty is, friends. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, in verse 17. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what?
Liberty.
And liberty is antithesis to slavery. Liberty is antithesis to slavery. And the Spirit of the Lord, friends, is never going to lead us contrary to what the Word of the Lord says through the Bible, which is written by the Spirit of God. As we said, slavery has two sides. There's the bondage of keeping the ceremonial law, and then there's the bondage of not obeying God's Ten Commandment law. And by the way, you know, it's interesting, James calls it the law of liberty twice. In James chapter 1, verse 25, and in James chapter 2, verse 12, he calls the Ten Commandments the law of liberty. In verse 8, he calls it the royal law. And so, friends, there's nothing that about the law itself that is bondage. It's our inability to keep the law that brings bondage. But Christ has given us the ability to walk free. God's work for you, friends, is a free gift. But as with all gifts, it does cost the giver something to give. You know, if a man comes home and, you know, there's something nice about having wildflowers, and they're pretty, and sometimes they can decorate a room quite nice, and if the man had to climb the hill to get to them and find them, the wife understands that thoughtfulness, and she appreciates them. But if they're just something given to him, and then he gives them to her, they don't mean quite as much, do they? They didn't come from the heart. It didn't cost that spouse, that husband, something to give her those flowers. But when it costs something, then it has a little extra meaning to it. The gifts that usually mean the most to us are the ones that we know cost someone something. They cost maybe personal effort, perhaps sweat, blood, and tears. But God gave it all for us, but we must also surrender all to Him and work with Him as we deny self and surrender to His molding. Remember the Flemish artist earlier? We talked about how he molded the clay. Well, God is the potter and we are the clay, but unlike this clay the Flemish man was working with, we're living clay. And we can refuse. We can resist His molding and His working and shaping. Can you imagine taking a small child and you're trying to dress this little boy or this little girl, and you say, now hold your arm out here, and they hold the other arm out, and you can't get the blouse on right, or they won't stick their leg out to get the trousers on right. You know, they can fight that and make it very hard. Now, of course, God is like a parent in the sense that God is more powerful than a child. God could overpower us. He could clothe us, supposedly, with His righteousness by force, but it really wouldn't be His righteousness anymore if it was by force. And He's too kind to work that way, and He knows it wouldn't be good. But if we will surrender, just think of a child, and you're trying to dress a child, and you say, now put out your right arm, the child puts out its right arm, and it smiles, and does everything in perfect choreographed order that you want it to do. It's very easy to put the clothes on the child and dress it, isn't it? But that child's fighting and kicking and screaming and who knows what else. But the more that child surrenders and submits, the easier it is to clothe, and the more we'll surrender and submit to God, the easier it will be for Him to clothe us with His robe of righteousness. The easier it will be for Him to mold us. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 16, Paul says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves slaves to obey, because the word translated servant is also translated slaves. Whom you yield yourselves, slaves to obey, His slave you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. We're going to be a servant of some kind. We can be a servant that we love Christ and we serve Him by love, or we can be a slave of Satan. It doesn't matter. The choice is yours. On January the 1st of 1863, President Abraham Lincoln issued what was called the Emancipation Proclamation as our nation stood upon the third year of its bloody Civil War. The proclamation declared that all persons held as slaves within the rebellious states, and it says, are and henceforth shall be free. And despite this expanded wording, the Emancipation Proclamation was limited in many ways. It applied only to the states that were in rebellion against the Union, leaving slavery untouched in the loyal border states. One of those was Maryland, by the way, slaveholding state. It also expressly exempted parts of the Confederacy that had already come under Northern control. But most important, the freedom it promised was dependent upon a Union military victory. Now, part of the Emancipation Proclamation also was the fact that the free black people in the North could join the army and be a part. Those who had been under dominion, those who had been liberated, could become liberators at that point. They could join the Union Army and the Union Navy. And by the end of the war, almost 200,000 black soldiers had. Soldiers and sailors, they fought for the Union, and they fought for their personal freedom. These soldiers sought for freedom. For freedom for themselves. For freedom of never being whipped by a master again. For freedom from being sold. For freedom for their families and not being separated again. You know, most slaves were sold at least once in their lifetime. It was so difficult sometimes to keep families together that among the black people, the preachers, they changed the wedding vows. It didn't say till death do us part, but till death or distance do us part. They didn't want that anymore. They fought for freedom, and many died securing that freedom. That freedom that you and I live and breathe today wasn't free. But neither is the ability we have to be free from sin free. In Romans chapter 6, in verse 22, it says, "And now being made free from sin and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ." And so the Lord says to us today, to each one of us, "I'm offering to set you free." If you are free, you can stay free. You don't have to become a slave to this world. You don't have to become a slave to Satan. You can be a servant of God, and you can benefit from all that He offers to us. A life that leads to holiness and finally results in eternal life. But don't ever forget, it costs God everything. And don't ever forget, it will cost you yourself. You must surrender all that you are and have to Christ. And then He will work within you to do His will and His good pleasure. And He offers that to each one of us. Brother Thomas, He offers it to me and to you. He offers it to Brother Kevin back here. And he'll do what He said He's done. He'll keep His promise. Our problem is we just have to believe the promise and then have to act upon it. And He will give us that which we need, if we will. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of His word. And may God bless you lots and lots.